Well, good afternoon. I hope you can hear me clearly. Maybe I'm not too loud.
Perfect.
So, I don't have a pocket, so I'm going to have to stay here in front. Wander up and down. So, my name is Lee Hanscher. I've had the privilege of already teaching on the course in Bologna. Here in the black box, we're talking about a black box subject. We've talked a lot about selectivity. And for me, having worked on the area of state aid for a long time, the best advice to anybody dealing with selectivity comes from Yogi Berra. And if you're an English-speaking person, you might know that Yogi Berra is very famous for all these sort of wise sayings, a bit like Johan Cruyff. For English, that's Johan Cruyff in Dutch. And one of his famous sayings is, if you come to a fork in a road, take it. And that's really saying how you have to reach a decision on selectivity. It's quite, I think, sometimes really, really difficult to rely on case law, because the case law is contradictory. So that doesn't really help us when we come in fiscal cases, in tax cases, to the issue of recovery. Because, of course, if we look at the general principles, the rules are quite simple. The national courts have the obligation to ensure that European law is implemented and that illegal aid is recovered. But that principle, of course, is much harder to apply in practice, and it can have far-reaching consequences. So, commissioned a study on the problems around recovery, and they're fairly well known. It wasn't always clear who had the responsibility to do so. It wasn't always clear who actually had to repay and the exact amount. It was often the case that procedures were missing at national level. For example, interim relief, I think this was French case especially, that there were no legal instruments at national level to recover aid or through interim relief, interim injunctions. Difficult to suspend recovery pending appeal. That was something the Commission didn't like, but in many member states, of course, that was possible, and that resulted in a lot of delay in recovery. And then, of course, the relationship between central government and local government, ensuring that local benefits, subsidies or state aid that had been illegally paid, had that been recovered? So the Commission had a lot of problems with the way member states behaved. But the Commission, of course, isn't always the good kid on the block. And the Commission, too, it's not always very clear in its decisions as to what should be recovered. Now, in principle, as we know from Article 16 of the procedural regulation, a commission must recover illegal aid unless, of course, that would result in the invocation of general principles of European law. Here, the role of legitimate expectations could play an important role. We don't know. There are very few cases where it has to be honoured. But to go back to what Raymond was saying, the court has always said, in principle, aid has to be But what the Commission often doesn't do, in, obviously, especially in cases that have that concern schemes, but not just state aid schemes, also individual aid, is it doesn't actually tell the member state how much it should recover. And the court has been quite lenient towards the Commission in saying, well, as long as you give general guidelines that allows the member state to assess how much should be recovered and can identify beneficiaries. I don't have to say who the beneficiaries are, but there should be enough general indications there for the member state to identify the beneficiaries, then that's sufficient. And I think the classic example of the Italian case, Mediaset, where the Commission actually required Italy to do a whole sort of hypothetical test to reconstruct a market that never was, but should have been had it not been for the measures that the Commission objected to. A similar one is long-term energy contracts in Hungary, and where again the Commission said, well, we don't like those long-term contracts for state aid. And you have to find out how much aid was given Hungary by reconstructing a market as if there were no long-term contracts. So it was a very complex exercise. So the general rule is that that once state aid is identified as incompatible, it should be recovered without delay. So it's usually within 2 months, although some decisions extend that. But of course, in accordance with national procedures. And it's here that we enter the black box. What are those national procedures? Do they exist? What we have seen, and I think an earlier stage of the course, you have had lectures and discussions about this, that the Court of Justice is getting quite tough as to what it requires from national courts. And there's a kind of consistent line in the jurisprudence. I think most recently that has been expressed in this German case, Klaus Holz, where the principle of res judicata was at issue. And the court said, well, you know, it's a bit like the fork in the road, just ignore it. And unless, of course, you're going to have to apply national law contra legem, but otherwise you have to give precedence to the judge. So this is quite, you know, I think quite a tough order to national judges on the part of the court. So now I'm in the black box, and I'm also a bit of a Martian in the black box, because it's my job to talk about the Netherlands. I'm not Dutch. I'm Scottish, and I was brought up in the sort of civil law culture, but there's a bit of common law as well. So I was brought up with the idea that if you have separate civil law and administrative law, that's actually undemocratic. That we have a famous treatise from the 19th century by Walter Budgett, where he was very critical of the idea of administrative law. And so for us, it's very strange that you have all the problems of, you know, on what legal basis a recovery decision should be taken, what type of court should look at it, what kind of procedure should apply. Generally, in a common law system, we don't really get involved with those kind of problems to the degree that it seems to occur in the civil law system. So that's my sort of Martian take on this. There are obviously lots of good reasons, but it's sometimes difficult to get into the history of the system to understand why all these different types of legal basis issues are so problematic. But they are there, and that's something I think I want to talk about. What I'm primarily going to look at is the new law, which went through the first chamber on Tuesday, and I believe will enter into force in July this year. But before I do that, I just want to look at just, you know, some of the statistics and ask, well, you know, we have this new law, but what's the problem? And in the last 10 years, in the last decade, there have actually only been two recovery decisions that the Commission has addressed to the Netherlands. One, I think you need to know and remind you about, Starbucks, and the other is a fairly obscure case called Leidschendam. There, of course, the amount to be recovered was much smaller than in the Starbucks case. In the preceding decade, there were 9 recovery decisions addressed to the Netherlands, so obviously things are getting better. And you can compare that rather meager record with the number of cases that have come before the court, where state aid has been argued with not much success, of course. Even less success than I remember with this microphone. So the success rate of 8%. So I want to just dwell a little bit. Is that better? I just want to talk a little bit about the Leidschendam case, because it raises some interesting issues with regard to recovery. And I think touches on a couple of questions that I think have been already raised for discussion later in the panel. With Starbucks, there has been a recovery order and pending annulment by the General Court or eventually the Court of Justice. So that is the rule. So you, just because you appeal against a commission decision doesn't mean that decision is suspended in any way. You still have to pay up, and that apparently has happened in Starbucks. I think normally the money is paid into some kind of escrow account, and there it stays until the case is settled. But Leidschendam was quite interesting because, just like Starbucks, it wasn't notified because nobody thought that there was an aid issue at stake. Now, to cut a very long story short, what happened here was that land was going to be developed in an area between Leiden and The Hague, and this was to be developed by a joint public-private partnership, land was sold by the local authority, transferred to this partnership. The deal had been negotiated over quite a period of time. The crisis hit, and the value of the land seemed to have decreased. And indeed, an independent valuation was obtained, and that confirmed that the price of the land had dropped. Somebody complained about this, the Commission conducted a full investigation, a formal investigation, and found that indeed there had been a breach of what we call the market investor operator principle, that no market operator would have sold the land at this cheap price. And therefore, they demanded that the difference between what the commercial value of the land should have been and the price had been sold at should be then recovered. They came to a figure of some nearly 7 million, but there was also the way, which included the waiver of a ground exploitation fee and another quality fee. So with that amount, nearly 7 million, had to be recovered within 2 months. It was a very controversial ruling on the part of the Commission, a decision on the part of the Commission for many reasons, whether or not this market economy just actually could have applied. It was contested by the parties successfully, and the Commission decision was annulled in the case that was decided in the course of 2014. So if a decision is annulled, the Commission has to take a new decision, so it reopened the formal investigation, and it had a closer look at the land valuation that the local authority had used to get to the price that it had sold the land back in 2009. So there was no aid. Now, quite interestingly, it seems that in this intervening period of 3 years, no aid has actually recovered. Now, in theory, the Dutch civil court, who ceased with the case, should have recovered the aid, even although it wasn't until 2016 that the Commission finally decided that it was compatible. But it didn't, because it decided that it was too complicated and that the private law contracts that underpinned the transactions didn't actually give an evident legal basis for recovery. Now, I'm taking that from the explanatory memorandum of that accompanies the new law. I haven't seen the underlying procedures before the Dutch Civil Courts. Maybe there was nothing published because nothing actually happened, but maybe somebody in the room knows more about that than I do. But it's a good illustration of the complexities of recovery. And it's a good illustration of a major problem, so which we're about to see, I think, with the new law. Another issue before I get to the new law is, of course, what happens when an entity, a public entity, makes mistakes and somebody benefits, perhaps unwittingly, from those mistakes, and it turns out that the mistaken calculations confer state aid. Well, we have, again, another important decision, I think well known, and that is from the Rabobank in the Dutch Equalisation Fund case, where the administration, the body charged with calculating who was allowed to get compensation from this health equalisation fund, they made a series of mistakes over 3 consecutive periods. And then they found out that these mistakes had been made. And they demanded that the money should be paid back by the health insurance fund that had obtained this wrongful compensation. And this picks up on a theme that we were talking a little bit about before the break. This duty of loyal cooperation that the Council of State interpreted very strictly that applied to all administrative bodies, and therefore they should have done their job properly, and they had a duty under European law to get that, to recover that compensation that in fact amounted to state aid. And that was based, there's been a discussion a lot in the Dutch literature about this case, but it was based on the unwritten general principles. And that sort of situation will now be covered by the new law, by Article 7 of the new law. And it strikes me that the Dutch Council of State interprets these European law obligations very strictly, also in the Ridder State case that was talked about just before. Now, what do we have until this new law kicks in? Well, we have 3 different systems, civil, admin, and fiscal, all with different rules when it comes to possible routes to recovery. And the new law then is meant to get rid of all the gaps and lacunas that are created partly because we have 3 different systems which could apply, so civil, fiscal, or administrative. So, and as you might recall, back something fast. One of the major lacuna in Dutch admin law has been that if a sum was to be recovered, according to European law, and there was no legal basis in Dutch law, and one had to rely on these general unwritten principles, this did not cover interest. And the Commission requires, confirmed by the court, that interest must be charged on the sum to be recovered. And this is important because even if aid which is not notified to the Commission, but subsequently comes to the Commission's notice and eventually is declared compatible, eventually, for the period that that money, that support, has been in the hands of a beneficiary, then it's still in legal state aid, even if it's subsequently declared to be compatible. And to kind of remedy that, the court has held that the Commission is entitled to require member states to recover interest on the financial advantage that had been enjoyed illegally prior to the declaration of compatibility. So the fact that you could not have find a legal basis to charge interest was actually quite a big problem when looked at from this European point of law point of view, that if you infringe the standstill principle and the beneficiary enjoys the aid prior to the formal clearance, there is still this recovery interest, we call it in European law, to be paid. So, looking then quickly over the landscape, why do we need this new law? And do we need a single basis? Do we need a national legal basis, given that we have so few recovery cases? It seems that we do have gaps. We do have sometimes also conflicting rules or rulings as well. For example, on this whole interest business with the controversial Dutch equalization, which seem to not even bother with the interest issue. There's been some discussions also as to who the beneficiary actually is. Sometimes it's maybe a case of looking through a construction to see who the indirect beneficiary is, who should recover, which public entity should be charged with the duty of recovering aid. Those are all things that were not clear. So the new law will provide a solution to all those issues, but it's limited, and it's limited to Commission decisions. It will not extend to national court proceedings where, let's say, a competitor has successfully passed through all the hoops of standing and gets judgment that a particular procedure or a particular form of support does confer state aid. This new law then will not apply in that case. That's because, at least in the view of the government, that here we're not confronted with the same gaps and problems. So Dutch law already provides for solutions to Dutch problems, in other words. union law and the whole issue of recovery on the basis of union law is not a good fit with Dutch law. So that's kind of the basis. So I'm going to jump back through. So the legislation first surfaced in 2008. I'm just going to skip about a couple of minutes. So the proposal to introduce some kind of legislation on recovery dates back to 2008, and it was introduced in response to the Florian Compost case, where it was evident that if there was no legal basis for recovery in Dutch law, and even if it was possible to rely on general unwritten law or to rely on the direct effect of Article 108, Article 3, there was still this problem of the interest. And the Netherlands was the threatened with infringement proceedings by the European Commission for not having an adequate legal basis to ensure the recovery of interest, and that was dropped. That infringement action was dropped. This is often the case. These things are often sort of negotiated away because there was a promise made at the time to introduce legislation to deal with this gap. And another issue that was to be dealt with at the same time was the issue of limitation periods. Because in the tax system in the Netherlands, as in many countries, the limitation periods are relatively short. European law limitation for recovering state aid is 10 years, but in the Netherlands it was normally either 3 or 5, and very exceptional, 12. So, for the fiscalists, of course, there was also the ongoing discussion of how do you actually institute a recovery? Is that then a new tax measure? And do you have to follow various procedures to introduce a new tax measure on someone who was taxed at an insufficient rate or had paid too little tax before? So, nothing much happened. That law was introduced before the second chamber. There was an opinion on it from our Council of State. And then it seemed to be just shelved until July 2016, when it re-emerged. And maybe somebody knows more about why it was suddenly kind of dusted down and taken off the shelf again, but it was. And we now then have a law that will enter into force in July of this year, which is quite unusual. There are not many member states that have a law on recovery, and we'll hear about the situation better in a minute. I think I recall that Italy didn't have one when we discussed it in Bologna. Spain has one, but I'm not terribly sure how it works. But I think having a single legal instrument is the exception rather than the rule. And I suppose the Netherlands would be a nice kind of guinea pig for test ground for seeing whether that's a good thing or not in the future. I think, just to sum up what the law will do, it will establish a uniform basis of recovery. It will only apply, as I said, to EC decisions. It will not apply to national court decisions. The government body that's responsible for having granted the aid will have to determine the issue of what's to be refunded and by whom, and charge interest. As a kind of incentive for these bodies to do that, they can not only reclaim the amount, but they can also keep it. So that might help them become more engaged in recovery procedures. Importantly, and as a result, I think, of quite a bit of lobbying, this general uniform procedure will not apply in tax cases. The normal tax system will be used to provide the instruments and the procedures for recovery of fiscal aid. Now, I'm sure, of course, there will be a lot of discussion as to what's fiscal aid and what's non-fiscal aid. That's maybe not always self-evident. The new legislation gives lists a series of taxes of instruments that will be covered under the fiscal leg. But I'm sure that there will be some nice para-fiscal levies and various charges that are equivalent to fiscal levies that will maybe not be difficult to know to which part of the system they will belong. Okay, so the law resolves the interest issue, so it's clear that interest will be recovered. It also states that it's clear that the interest has to be paid from the day that it's available. So that could be quite considerable sum of money. And it makes clear that the limitation period will be restricted to 10 years. So I made a very quick summary for the non-touch tickers of what the articles say. And I thought I would conclude with some questions. Not that important to have the answers, but maybe that's something worthwhile to discuss. Given that the new law will be limited to recovery on the basis of PC decisions and we've only had two of them, is it really worth the effort? Do we really need it? And I mean, it's advertised, if you like, as being a very straightforward, simple remedy that will close all the gaps. I think that's a good thing. Maybe we could think about whether in the original proposal fiscal aid was included. Now it's not. It's a separate procedure. And what about judicial protection? What about deed, the Lights and Dam case, where after 4 years, the whole decision of the Commission is effectively annulled? What would have happened in that case had this law been applicable and that sum of money had to be recovered? Now, I should add there that there's a very nice phrase, I like it very much, in the explanatory memorandum, where the minister quite often repeats the phrase that the actual, let's say, implementation of the recovery order into private contracts and civic relations is something that will have to be tackled according to the normal procedures of Dutch law. So there seems to be a kind of line drawn in the sand that this new law provides a basis for adopting the recovery decision process for recovery, but what the consequences of all that are going to be on civil relations between parties and underlying contracts, not tackled, too complex, and perhaps that's indeed the case. But it raises also, I think also this aspect raises the issue of judicial protection. And maybe then from that perspective, the appeal procedures are all focused and channeled to the CPD. And is that then also desirable? Is that should be looking wider? Is this all in the interest of efficiency or judicial protection maybe minimized for the sake of efficiency? So those are all questions I thought that were useful maybe to discuss, and maybe also to think about in the context of when we hear about Belgium, where there is no new single instrument for recovery, but quite different system. I don't know if you want me to take questions.
No, just the...